Meeting of the City of Adelaide on Tuesday, 28th of February 2017. The Lord Mayor is in the chair. The council meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is being taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed of, or published publicly by the council, including transferring outside of Australia. The red light to my right indicates that the meeting is being filmed and streamed.
Adelaide City Council acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains. It pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Council acknowledges the vision of Colonel William Light in determining the site for Adelaide and the design of the city with its six squares and surrounding belt of continuous parklands, which is recognised on the National Heritage List as one of the greatest examples of Australia's planning heritage.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we ask your blessing upon the works of the City of Adelaide. Direct and prosperous deliberations to the advancement of your glory and the true welfare of the people of this city. Amen.
Will all present remain standing in silence in memory of those who gave their lives in defence of their country at sea, on land, and in the air. Members, ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Members, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the meeting dated Tuesday, the 28th of February 2016. We declare the meeting open, of course. And members, I will take you to apologies and leaves of absence, of which we have nil. We have a full complement of members in the chamber this evening. So I'll take you directly onto item six on your agenda, members, which is confirmation of minutes from our last meeting held on the 14th of February 2017. Councillor Martin so moves. Can I have a seconder for those minutes, please, members? Councillor Corbell, thank you. Members, any debate? We'll move those straight to be put. Councillor Martin, those in favour? Those against? We'll carry the minutes duly from the meeting held on 14th of February 2017. Members, item seven on our agenda this evening is public forum and deputations, of which we have nil of both of those. We have nil petitions on item eight. So members, that takes us directly onto item nine on your agenda papers. We have the advice from the Adelaide Parklands Authorities and reports of other committees. So members, first of all, we have advice from the Adelaide Parklands Authority from a meeting held on the 16th of the 2nd, 2017, regarding Park 24 and regarding the proposed City of Adelaide helipad further investigation. So members, this is advice to note. So can I please have a mover for that? Councillor Martin to move. Do I have a seconder? Councillor Corbell, thank you very much. Members, is there any questions that you would like to ask administration or with regards to the advice which has been put forth by APLA?
Just one small point, Lord Mayor, and I have raised this with the administration. The wording of the recommendations that went to APLA is such that APLA appears to be instructing the administration to pursue courses of action before any such matter has been before council, and I acknowledge that the administration will adjust the wording in future so that it pays due regard to the process that involves council signing off.
That's quite correct, Councillor Martin. Of course, APLA is a body which provides advice to Adelaide City Council, and Adelaide City Council is a decision-making body. Any further questions, Councillor Martin? Councillor Wilkinson, my mistake.
Lord Mayor, as a member of APLA, who was there at the discussion, what actually transpired in the meeting was that the mood of the meeting was reaching a resolve that what APLA supported was two-storey buildings that were undercroft, with the lower level being half underground, so only a metre out of the ground. But that was not able to be put because we ran out of members of APLA to move an amendment to have that effect. So this report noting APLA's position is in effect really misconstruing what the mood of APLA was, and we, APLA as a member, we were not able to rectify that just for procedural reasons. I'm a bit concerned that with this noting, and then noting that the administration will enter lease arrangements with the affected parties, that they'll be doing it on the basis of doing a full-blown two-storey building sticking out of the parklands, rather than an undercroft solution, so which all agreed was the way to go. So I want to, I'm not sure if I can move an amendment as a motion without notice later in the meeting.
Okay, I can help you there, Councillor Wilkinson. You can't, but I'm just going to throw, because this matter will be coming before Council, so I'm going to just hand to Director Claremont that'll help clarify for the members.
Through the presiding member, the Part 24 building report will return to Council. That will be in April. Obviously, the concerns and discussion raised at APLA will form part of that report, and the feedback that a Council member on APLA sought will certainly be part of that consideration around costing and undercrofting.
Yeah. So can I actually assist you, Councillor Wilkinson, if I could please? Just to Director Claremont, can I ask, this is for noting, but there will be a full and thorough debate by Council in April on that matter, and the Council will have an opportunity to support or amend or whatever he so chooses at that time. Is that correct?
My question following that is...
That's correct, Lord Mayor.
On that date, will Council administration already have gone into a lease agreement with the affected parties, such that we might be then told, no, well, they've agreed on the basis of doing a two-storey out of the ground, not an undercroft. So,
through the presiding member, the lease agreement wasn't or didn't form part of APLA's considerations at that point in time, and we are a way away from determining what that lease arrangement could be. So the answer is no.
Well, so I hope from that it's we're not going to find ourselves being told it's too late and already agreed. So
you've been given those assurances by administration, Council. Members, any further questions regarding the APLA papers to note? Otherwise, I'm going to hand that back to our mover to sum up and move.
Summed up.
So, members, for your consideration, those in favour, those against, we will carry item 9.1. Thank you, members. Members, I take you on to item 9.2, which is the recommendation of the Strategic Planning and Development Policy Committee. I'm going to hand to the committee chair.
Am I doing 9.2 and 9.3 both?
I'll do them separately if I can encourage you, Committee Chair, but can you just, if we could just acknowledge your fellow member to your right, Councillor Wilkinson, I think we have a declaration of interest here. Is that right? Would you, Councillor, would you like to speak to that, just declare your interest, and then I'll hand back to Councillor Maloney.
Okay, that's what
you're
talking about. So it's about 9.2.
Yes, so on 9.2, as previously, I declare a conflict of interest in relation to the Channel 9 site because I provide professional advice to the developer of that site. So I'll absent the room at this point.
Thank you for advising your fellow members. I'll hand it back to the committee chair, Councillor Maloney.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
May I raise a matter of conflict?
Sorry. My apologies. Sorry, Councillor.
I just wish to raise a matter of conflict. Look, I thank the administration for the training in conflict provided to elected members by legal firm Kellerley and Jones, and consistent with the precedent involving Petrosky and Payne, I request you, Lord Mayor, to clarify with any member of this elected body who may have had but has not previously declared conflict of interest in either the Channel 9 or the McKinnon Parade DPA to be given the opportunity to do so.
Councillor, the onus lies on the members, should they have a perceived material or actual conflict of interest in any of these matters, to declare it. Councillor Wilkinson has done exactly that. So members, I look to the floor, as I would with any other matter. If you believe that you have a perceived actual material conflict of interest associated with these matters, I ask you to put your hand up. I'll take questions before I hand you. Please bear with me, Councillor. Committee Chair, Councillor Antic.
Just a question. Can we clarify the nature of it? I didn't understand the nature of that suggestion, perhaps.
Lord Mayor, I was just saying that it would be good. You accepted a declaration of a conflict of interest from Councillor Wilkinson, and I was asking you, consistent with the training that we've received from Kellerley and Jones, to ask if anyone else has a conflict of interest in the Channel 9 or McKinnon Parade DPA after Councillor Wilkinson has declared that. Now, if someone has a conflict of interest, I accept that you have now put that question, and I'd assume that if they had, they would have declared it. Thank
precisely,
you.
Precisely, Councillor. Thank you. I now, members. Okay, members, I don't, unless I have any perceived actual material conflicts, we're moving on. I hand this matter to the committee chair, Councillor Maloney.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'll move 9.2 as the recommendation and call for a seconder.
Councillor Moran is your seconder. Councillor Maloney, would you wish to speak to it?
No, Lord Mayor, I don't.
Councillor Moran, you're the seconder. Would you wish to speak to item 9.2? Members, do we have any debate regarding matter item 9.2? Councillor Martin?
Yes, Lord Mayor. Look, I won't be supporting this, as I previously mentioned at committee. And for the record, I want to express my reasons again. I think this is, on all of the indications, a great development for North Adelaide on that site. And given the proposed developer's strong track record at delivering quality outcomes, I believe this will be a superior development. But whatever my personal opinion, it is not the outcome that ratepayers desired in the public consultation. I have been personally lobbied by a large number of them who oppose six stories and would prefer four. On the matter of the McKinnon Parade delisting, I was once prepared to accept that. However, I've now come to the conclusion that it's a contradiction to be advocating that we remove heritage listings on altered properties, while at the same time in other parts of North Adelaide, in other DPAs, we're arguing that they should be applied, and therefore I won't be supporting that either.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Members, any further debate? Councillor Moran, I think you reserved your right as a seconder. Do you wish to speak?
No.
Councillor Maloney, committee chair, you moved.
Summed up.
Members, I put for your consideration, which is item 9.2 in your papers. Those in favour? Members, I'm getting half hands here. Who's voting, members?
Parts
I'm doing 9.2.
All together.
Yep. Okay, members, I'll call again. Those in favour of 9.2. Those against? Motion carries. Councillor Wilkinson can please rejoin the gallery. Maybe the chamber, not the gallery.
It's
going to
sit up there.
Freudian slip, that's right.
Yes.
Certainly, Councillor, thank you.
Members, we've just come out of the committee meeting, which makes the recommendation of 9.3, which is now being distributed to you. So I'll move and call for a seconder.
Seconded by Councillor Moran. Committee Chair, I've got the CEO who just might want to say a quick word, if you don't mind, before which time you proceed. CEO?
Through you, Lord Mayor, I'd like to invite Shanti Dizza to give an explanation as to the changes that we've made recently to this motion. Thanks, Shanti.
Then I'll hand the matter straight back to you, Committee Chair.
Through the Lord Mayor, thank you, CEO. There has been a sense of confusion around what option three means in the context of the committee meeting that was held earlier on tonight. Option three provided a range of options for council to consider on the subject of both built form, specifically height, and land use. The motion that that committee adopted earlier on this evening had a number of amendments, and I'd just like to speak to each of those amendments separately. The first one, which I understand you've got before you, which is item 1.2.1, first dot point, that all the institutions remain within their existing boundaries. That subject was not canvassed in option three, so it's actually a new item. Dot point two, maintaining over the increased height limits as non-complying for all sites. I refer you specifically to item number 12.3.1, 12.3.2, and 12.3.3. In summary, those items were presented so that council could either accept one, two, or three of the options, or all three of them in a collective sense. What the maintaining the over increased height limits for non-compliant for all sites essentially means is that non-compliant provisions would apply to all of the institutional sites in the North Adelaide institution zones. The Minister has put forward a proposition to Council that portion of the St Mark's site, specifically the corner of Commode Street and King William Street, have its height decreased from 4 to 3 storeys. And essentially, the motion that was carried in committee was that Council accept that proposition and that Council accept this non-compliant provision on that portion of the St Mark's site. The fourth dot point, Kathleen Lumley College, increasing the height from 3 to 4 storeys. Council's original position was that the Kathleen Lumley College site was maintained at 3 storeys. The Minister has come back with a proposition that that be increased to 4 storeys. Committee has resolved to accept the 4 storeys, however, retain a non-complying provision for the Kathleen Lumley site. The Minister has not proposed that, and I refer you to item 12.3.2 on the committee papers. Finally, in relation to the Women's and Children's Hospital site, I refer you to item 12.3.3 of the committee papers. That committee accepted that the Women's and Children's Hospital site north of Commode Street be increased from 8 to 14 storeys. So that addresses, in essence, item 12.3.1, 12.3.2, and 12.3.3. The areas that have not been addressed as part of the resolution from committee is items 12.3.4 and 12.3.5. Now, specifically, those items refer to land use activity for the college's sites and for St Dominic's Priory College site, Calvary Hospital site, and the Helping Hand Aged Care site. The first dot point in committee, that all the institutions remain within their existing boundaries, essentially mean that those institutions do not expand beyond the boundaries of the existing sites. However, it does not adequately cover the concern or the issue that might be of concern in relation to educational establishments being established on those colleges' sites. So I'd just like to alert you to that point. This motion doesn't address educational activities other than student accommodation actually establishing on those colleges' site. Finally, the St Dominic's Priory College, Calvary Hospital and Helping Hand aged care sites, the issue of the institutions being restricted to within the boundaries of the existing sites does capture 12.3.5. So the item that is outstanding in relation to option three is 12.3.4, which is allowing on merit uses of educational establishments in the college's sites.
Shanti, thank you. Members, I hope that helps inform a full and thorough debate. Committee Chair, Councillor Maloney, floor is yours.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. There's two options here. I guess I can move it, and then to address that issue, Councillor Hender can amend, or I can let Councillor Hender speak and take it as a variation.
Councillor, you have moved it, and Councillor Moran seconded it.
All right, then in that case, it's an amendment then.
Yep, correct. So, Councillor, Deputy Lord Mayor, before you do speak, did you wish to reserve your right?
I was there.
And Councillor Moran, did you wish to reserve your right? Okay. Deputy Lord Mayor, the floor is yours.
I'd like to propose an amendment that we add two dot points actually to 1.2.1, and they are two additional amendments to not allow on merit consideration of educational establishment uses on student accommodation sites. That's the first dot point. And the second dot point is Shani, you might help me with the language for this, to the retain the non-complying provisions for shops on Strangways Terrace frontage of Calvary Hospital. Would that be right, accurate?
Through the Lord Mayor, that's correct.
If I could get a seconder, I could explain those two.
Councillor Martin's your seconder. Deputy Lord Mayor, floor is yours.
So, Lord Mayor, in the few moments we had between the committee and the council meeting, I had the opportunity to talk to Shanti and just get some clarity on this. I initially was on the understanding that option one was our original position, option two was the minister's response, and option three, what we voted for as option three, was a complete capture of our administration's response to the minister's response. As it turns out, we missed two things. We missed that our administration was actually clearly advising us that we should oppose oppose the on-merit consideration for educational establishment uses on student accommodation sites. Our administration's view is that that's not something we should concede, and our administration's view was also that we should not concede shops on Strangways Terrace. On the basis of getting that information from our administration, and on the understanding that what we've done is we've gone out with a position, the minister has come back with a position, and then we've softened our position based on the administration, based on the minister's view, but having taken advice, expert advice from our own staff, what I'm proposing is actually simply that we accept the expert advice of our own staff. That's, I hope, what I've achieved by this amendment. Am I right, Shanti?
Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. Members, that amendment would appear on your screens. It was seconded by Councillor Martin. Councillor Martin, do you wish to speak to it?
I reserve my last.
Members, any debate on the amendment? Any debate on the amendment? Councillor Clarahan?
Yes, I thank Deputy Lord Mayor for this amendment, I think that would allay a lot of concerns. We are talking about, for example, residential student colleges, and with this amendment, we can avoid seeing them become anything other than residential student colleges. So I thank her for it.
Well, may I request that it be taken, the amendment be taken in parts?
If the Member agrees.
The Deputy Lord Mayor, you're moving an amendment. You've got two parts to it, I understand. Are you happy for them to be taken in parts when it comes to the vote?
Yes, but I would like to make the point that they're both based, those points are both added on the basis that they're the advice that have been given to us by our administration.
It's your decision, Deputy Lord Mayor. You're happy to take them in parts? Yes, you are. And seconded, have you taken in parts? All right, we'll take those in parts. Members, I'm going to deal with part one at this point in time. So is there any further debate on part one, as in a proposed amendment for part one? So there's no debate on part one, so members... It's on your screen. So members, please work with me here. We've got an amendment from the Deputy Lord Mayor, which is in two parts. We are taking them in parts. So we're going to vote on the first part, which is, starting with, not allow on-merit consideration of education establishment uses on the student accommodation sites. Any debate on that matter? And this is an amendment, a proposed amendment at this point in time. No, I'm going to ask you to vote on that proposed amendment. Those in favour? Those against? So that part of the proposed amendment becomes an amendment, and that becomes part of the substantive. I'm now going to take you to the second part, which is retain the non-complying provisions of shops on Strangways Terrace frontage. Is there any debate on that, members? So I'll take that to the vote. Members, those for part two, those in favour, those against. Thank you, Deputy Lord Mayor. We now have a new substantive motion, which was moved by Councillor Malani. So do we have any debate on the new substantive motion as amended? Councillor Malani, for you to... Oh, Councillor Wilkinson.
Yes, no, I'm pleased that we... my amendment about maintaining the non-compliance for going over and above the increase, significantly increased height limits is non-complying. But do note that the increase in height of the Women's and Children's Hospital from 8 storeys to 14 storeys, the current provision allows for up to 8 storeys near the middle of the site. This will allow potentially 14 storeys across the whole site, such that the development potential and value of the Women's and Children's Hospital site is ostensibly, theoretically doubled, virtually doubled by virtue of this amendment without going to public consultation, which I think is concerning. But that in effect is the effect of that change to that height limits on that site, such that that hospital site, when that is sold by this or a future government, could then be sold as an apartment development up to 14 storeys rather than 8 storeys, obviously has considerably more value than it does presently. So I just wanted to point out that has a very significant impact on the value of that site.
Thank you for pointing that out, Councillor. I now go back to Committee Chair, Councillor Malani, to sum up. Members, I put the substantive motion before you. Those in favour? Those against? We carry. Thank you, members. Members, item 10 on your agenda is the Lord Mayor's report. Members, I will read to you briefly. I will then seek a mover and a seconder to note and receive. Members, I recently met with Chief Minister of the ACT, Andrew Barr, where we signed a cooperation agreement between the City of Adelaide and Canberra and the ACT to investigate opportunities to collaborate in our Smart City agenda. It is clear, members, that the City of Adelaide and Canberra are leading the national debate, the national agenda when it comes to smart city technology. It makes very good sense for us to collaborate. Last week I attended the Climate Action Roundtable in Cairns, where state and territory environment ministers, along with quite a number of mayors and local government representatives, explored opportunities for collaboration amongst sub-national governments on sustainability and, in particular, economic development opportunities associated with it. Last weekend, members, I attended the launch of the Inner City Street Crew by Minister Zoe Bettison with our Associate Director Sean McNamara. Now, members, this new program puts up to 9 inner city street crew onto our city streets 7 days a week to connect the homeless with services and beds. Now, we believe this has got the ability to be quite transformational, members, and there has been concern about the growing incidence of homelessness in the city of Adelaide, a trend which very unfortunately is playing out nationally. This is a very good proactive move in the right direction to connect people in need with beds and services. This debate, members, as you know, is not entirely about beds. It's about wrapping services around people most in need so that they stay in the beds and begin to transition their lives. So I will report to you periodically, members, about the progress of this, but at this point in time, I think it's a very commendable initiative. And I thank our director, Sean McNamara, for his relentless passion and drive in this area. Members, as you would also know, that yesterday there was the announcement between the state government of South Australia and 5 inner metropolitan councils regarding the $140 million funding package for flood mitigation works for the Brownhill Keswick Creek catchment area, of which has been 10 years in the making. So a very good outcome to finally get this done. We are advocating for Victoria Park to be one of the early outcome projects, which would take pressure off South Terrace, the flooding we saw in 2016, and take a lot of pressure off West Torrens, because of course they are downstream from us. Lunar New Year, members, Lady Merris and I attended, as I'm sure you did, quite a number of events on behalf of the City of Adelaide, including the Chinatown Street Party, which was a terrific cultural event. We also attended the 69th anniversary of the independence of Sri Lanka and a number of other events throughout the city celebrating Lunar New Year. Members, in recent weeks with Mike Philippou, I have been on your behalf meeting with various stakeholder groups regarding the Adelaide Central Market Arcade. And we have met with the arcade traders, the Central Market traders, the Goodger Street traders, the Grote Street traders, Chinatown traders, and the resident group, as in all of our resident groups, to talk about where we are at with public consultation on the land revocation for the Central Market Arcade. We are doing some very strong and positive engagement in that area, and I thank Mike Philippou and the administration team for their work. The southern side of North Terrace has great potential for rejuvenation, and its uplift is one of our key strategic priorities. And in fact, we've funded $5 million towards exactly that with the state government's extension of the tram down North Terrace to the ORA. So on behalf of council, I have been attending a number of meetings recently with North Terrace property owners to ensure that there is strong collaboration. I recently provided a speech on the importance of entrepreneurship at the Australian New Zealand International Business Academy at the University of South Australia and attended an inaugural Shandong Chamber of Commerce South Australia Chinese Entrepreneurs Summit dinner right here at Adelaide Town Hall last week and provided a speech about the importance of entrepreneurial exchange between Adelaide and our sister city of Qingdao. The Lady Mayoress recently gave an opening address for the North Adelaide Golf Women's Winter Season. The Lady Mayoress has also been working with the Zonta Club for their upcoming Women of Achievement Awards and gave a speech at the Royal Overseas League South Australian branch about the history of the Lady Mayoress and supporting the achievement of women in business and society. Finally, members, I present this plaque to you. It was a gift from the Ambassador of Italy, His Excellency Mr. Pier Francesco Zazzo, and the commanding officer of the Italian Navy frigate, Carabinieri, Commander Francesco Pagnotta, when they visited Adelaide recently, part of the federal government future frigate tender program. So there's obviously, members, a great deal of activity in the defence space. Members, I ask that this be received and duly noted, and I ask a member to move that my verbal update be taken on board in good faith. Councillor Clearhand, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Members, can I ask you to move that? Those in favour? Thank you very much, members. We move on. Members, your reports. Page 8 of the papers, item 11.1, reports from council members. Members, would any members like to speak about recent pursuits? Councillor Martin?
Yeah, just a couple of seconds, Lord Mayor. I want to thank you, and I know this is the second time tonight that I've done that, but I do want to thank you for allowing me, when protocol would have dictated that the job went to you, to launch the automatic external defibrillators in public places program. The DFIB's based in Rundle Mall and Victoria Square are part of a trial, which I hope will be successful and eventually lead to the rollout across the city. But I particularly rose to my feet to thank the staff who worked so hard and so long to make it such a success, and I'm indebted to them.
Thank you, Councillor Martin, and thank you on behalf of your fellow elected members for a good initiative. Members, any further debate regarding your activities of late? Otherwise, I'll ask someone to move. Councillor Maloney, seconded by Councillor Rabiard. Those in favour? We carry. Thank you, members. Members, that takes us on to item 12.1 in your papers. Members, this is a matter regarding a delegation from the Middle East and North Africa in March 2017, as per an invitation from the State Government of South Australia, most particularly Minister Martin Hamilton-Smith. Members, I'm going to ask you first for a procedural motion, before which time I then call for nominations. If there are any questions associated with this matter, we have Matt Grant from our Economic Development Team, our Associate Director. So, members, can I have a procedural motion moved by Councillor Maloney, seconded by Councillor Clearhand? So this just it's a procedural motion for points 1 and 2. Those in favour? Those against? We carry the procedural motion. Now, members, which is what we typically do in these matters, members, I now ask for nominations. Councillor Maloney?
Lord Mayor, I nominate Councillor Abiad.
Councillor Abiad, do you accept if nominated?
Yes, Lord Mayor.
Do we have any further nominations, members? We don't, so I'll need a seconder for that nomination. I've got it with Councillor Clearhand, and I'm going to need Councillor Rabiard to leave the chamber.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, members, can I have a motion, please, to confirm, and I'll look to you, Councillor Maloney, a motion to confirm that Councillor Rabiard is nominated?
Yes.
Thank you. Take that as yes, and I'll take your seconder again, is Councillor Clearhand. So, members, any debate on this matter? There's no debate on this matter. I go back to you to sum up.
Summed up.
Summed up by Councillor Maloney. Those in favour, members? Can't see your hands, members. Sorry, can I have that again? Those in favour? Those against? And we carry. Thank you, members. If we could please invite Councillor Abiard back into the chamber. Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Members, moving along, please. Item 12.2, feedback on building upgrade finance consultation, page 15 of your papers. You have a recommendation to note and endorse. I've got a mover with Councillor Maloney. Do I have a seconder? I do, with Councillor Martin. Councillor Martin, you wish to speak to this?
Oh, I think that's me. Yeah, thank you. Just very briefly, look, it's I was pleased to see that the Parliament passed this amendment to the Act on a couple of years ago, and now we're getting some consultation on it. But I just, you know, it's great to see this almost come a full circle, because it was actually in this chamber where we discussed taking what was back then, I think we called it the environmental finance upgrade based on what other states were calling it. But it's great to see that this is progressing almost to the point now where we're looking at seeing some tangible outcomes from it. So I'm very pleased to see that. I just wanted to ask a quick question through you, Lord Mayor. is that when the consultation is complete and there has been the amendments made to the regulations, will we just get a report on then what happens next?
I'll refer that through our CEO, Councillor Milan.
Michelle English, thank you.
Yes, through the Chair, absolutely would bring a report back to Council in relation to what happens next. So, for example, Council would need to agree to participate to offer building upgrade finance. So that would form part of that report.
And then, I mean, this legislation is obviously the enabler for us to do that. Is that?
Yes, through the Chair. So I understand that the State Government is currently working with a number of property owners to look at utilising this mechanism for upgrading buildings. And we're not privy to which ones that they are, but I expect some of those could be within the City of Adelaide. And we would be looking at how we could quickly facilitate that through Council operations.
Thank you, Michelle. I guess I'd be interested in that process, whether it's a briefing or whatever it is, because, and then if it is, for example, open to people for them to apply, I guess it's rather than just selecting. But all in all, the consultation feedback is good, and I hope we see some action taken in this area soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Councillor Martin, you seconded. Do you wish to speak?
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Members to the floor, any debate? Councillor Maloney, back to you for a sum up. Members, over to you for a vote. Those in favour? Those against? We carry item 12.2. Thank you, members. Members, item 12.3, public space recycling bins, page 28 of your papers, to note and endorse. I've got Councillor Corbell with hand up as a mover, and we have a seconder with Councillor Corbell.
Point of clarification, Lord Mayor, I actually have provided an alternative motion already. Am I able to move?
Yes, you can do that.
It's a deferral motion, which I'd seek a seconder for, and it's up on your screen.
Okay, I had Councillor Martin's hand up first to second it, so would you like to, you can if you wish, debate it, or we can just move straight to a vote. It is up to you. You can share with your fellow members your reasoning.
You can share with your members your reasoning for your deferral if you wish. Yeah, so may I, back in December, I called for a study on the possibility of bringing recycling bins into the city, and I was actually looking for a really comprehensive report, and although I've got some of the information that I asked for, I don't believe that all of it is provided in here. In particular, some of the costing options that have been reported are quite excessive. I'm really keen to get recycling bins in the city. We've got a couple here and there, in particular down Rundle Mall, but it was a unanimous decision to support this of council. There seems to be appetite from this council to have recycling bins in the public realm for collecting recyclables. It doesn't necessarily have to be that we're collecting organic waste, but there is a need for us to have a discussion about this, and I'd like to defer it to a workshop so that we can talk about what some of the options are and preferences for recycling bin costing options, and the opportunity to take this from an existing budget. So I seek your support in this.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Warmly embraced by the gallery. Councillor Martin, you seconded?
Yes, Lord Mayor. Look, I warmly endorse this idea. Councillor Corbell's proposal is an excellent one. I note from the information supplied to us there are other subjects which are canvassed and I think which are worthy of discussion in a workshop, including the proposal of Councillor Vachon for compostable takeaway containers to be diverted away from landfill. And I note there's a trial proposed where I would have thought something more substantial would have been better. And in addition, I think there's a proposal in there for the introduction of recycling containers of the sort that Councillor Corbell is proposing for events from 2019. Now, that is something that I think deserves a much more detailed conversation in a workshop, and so I support and endorse entirely this amendment.
So we have an alternate motion before us to defer. So, Councillor Rabiot.
The reason I do speak for the deferral and I do support the intent of the motions, one of the things that did come up in the discussion also was if we are going to replace bins around the city and we're talking about smart city technology and everything else, I think it's also important that we look at the opportunity of understanding how we can pick up some efficiencies from the bins that we'll be installing, especially around some of the digital bins where it could tell us specifically if they're full, not full, if they've been emptied. So that will translate to some efficiencies within our organisation. So if you have some concerns around the budget line and around the cost to roll this out across the city, potentially that could be translated in the way of a return on investment based on the efficiencies that council will be able to achieve as a result. So the reason I do support the deferral, and maybe administration can take this on notice or not notice, just as a recommendation potentially to discuss at a workshop, for us to look at if we are going down this path, can we look at the opportunity of the installation of some of those digital based or smart bins that will assist us in creating the efficiencies that we need as a council.
Thank you, Councillor. Members, any further debate? Otherwise, I hand you back to Councillor Corbell to sum up on the motion to defer.
Let's recycle waste, not recycle old debates.
With that in mind, members, I put this for your consideration. Those in favour? Those against? So this item will be deferred. Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Waste not, want not.
No.
No pun intended. Members, we now go to item 12.4 on your agenda, significant tree removal in Hurtle Square and regulated tree removal in Park 15. It's a report for approval. Do I have a mover? Councillor Clarehan, seconded by Councillor Moran. Councillor Clarehan, do you wish to speak to this? Councillor Moran, a second, did you wish to speak to this?
No, Lord Mayor.
Members, any debate? Back to you, Councillor Clarehan. Members, to you for the vote. Those in favour? Those against? We will carry that item. Members, I take you straight on to item 12.5, electric vehicle demand update, page 44. It is a report to note. Can I put that in your hands? Councillor Moran is moving. I've got a second of Councillor Slama. Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to the report?
No, self-explanatory, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Slama, do you wish to speak to the report? Councillor Wilkinson.
I'm happy to go along with this because we're trying to be the a green carbon neutral city. But I think it's important that when we come to looking at the rollout of the equipment pertaining to this, that we do it with machines like our car park ticketing machines, but when people pay for parking, they put their Visa card into the parking machine and they pay for their parking. I don't see any reason why ratepayers should be just providing free electricity for people, users of the facilities. It should be user pay facilities, so that when people plug in and people who can afford an electric car will be grateful for these facilities, but there's no reason why other ratepayers should be giving them free electricity. And then I think people using them will be quite happy to pay for the electricity that they use and grateful for council providing the electric charge facilities without giving away the electricity for nothing. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Councillor. Any further comments, members? Councillor Moran, back to you.
Yes, I'm happy to move this in the assurances from you, Lord Mayor, and the administration that this doesn't lock us into anything. With a recent announcement by Ford that they wouldn't be producing any more electric cars till 2025, our initial target of 40 plus clearly is ridiculous. The green car revolution has turned to hybrids and has turned away from electric cars. And until there's a need, I'm assured that that when this report comes up, it won't actually have us locked into anything.
Assurances provided, Councillor. This matter will come before you, members, in April 2017 for a full debate. At the moment, this is an FYI in terms of information, in terms of a status update, I guess. So this will come back to you, members. Thank you, Councillor. So I put this all for you to receive and note. Those in favour, those against, we carry Thank you very much, members. I take you on to item 12.6, Main Street Historic Building Facade Improvement Scheme. Councillor Wilkinson's handed up and Councillor Abiyard looks like he's seconding.
I'd like to move an amendment, please. That the scheme...
Councillor, sorry, just for the benefit of your fellow members, are you moving an alternate motion?
Yes, yes.
Well, an amendment to the motion.
So that can be an alternate motion, because you're doing that as the move, that's what you need to do. I'm guiding you here, Councillor.
Yeah.
So your alternate motion will be the substantive motion, I suspect, plus a change.
Yeah, and also just for the record, I'd like to declare a perceived conflict of interest, because through my work, I often work or sometimes work with older historic buildings, so I want to declare that and be honest and transparent about that, but I don't consider that to be a material conflict of interest, that I want that to be out in the open. The amendment would be that the scheme be available to pre-World War II historic character buildings only, and part three, that a report be brought back to council in 12 months' time.
I'm interested in this debate.
Yes, so you're second for the purposes of the debate, Councillor Abiyard.
Thank you,
Councillor. I'll just check that we have got your new your alternate motion in place so you can speak to it. It looks like we do. Yes, the wording's being tidied up in front of us on the screens.
That the scheme be available to pre-World War II.
Councillor Wilkinson, I'll ask you to look at your screen and just confirm that that reflects what you're attempting to do, and then I'll give you 3 minutes to speak to the matter, and then...
Can I ask a question, Lord Mayor? Sorry. Point one says endorse the new policy guidelines, and then it's got that the scheme be available to only that niche. I don't know about... That doesn't make sense to me. We can't endorse these guidelines, but then make it relevant to that niche.
I'll take advice on that, Councillor Brady. You're asking me whether there's a conflict between one and two.
I think I'm telling you there's a conflict
between one and two. I think you might be, Councillor Maloney. Let me take advice. Our CEO.
Through you, Lord Mayor. Shanti Ditta, thanks.
Through the Lord Mayor, can I refer members to Attachment A to the report, specifically item 4 on page 58, which refers to the operating guidelines eligibility, specifically item 4.1.1, which references building types. We would reword that part of the document to refer to buildings pre-World War II being restricted for the fund.
Yes, I'm happy with that.
Well, that needs to be specified in the...
I'm happy just to adjust my wording that the guidelines be amended to make the scheme available.
4.1.1
Well, Councillor Wilkinson, the wording you have on the screen now, does that reflect your intent?
Yes, it does.
It does. Now I'll take advice from administration. Administration, with the addition of point 2 and point 3, is that right? What's happening here? It's just changed. Okay. So we've got a change to part 1, we've got inclusion of part 2. CEO, does that provide any conflict, or can that, as a motion, should it be successful, be interpreted into an adjustment into the policy guidelines supporting it?
I'm advised it's quite a workable proposal.
Okay, thanks, Councillor Maloney. Councillor Wilkinson, the floor is yours. You've got 3 minutes.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's implicit with these sort of amendments that it follows that the guidelines are amended to reflect the building will or vote of council subject to this being voted on. As the instigator of the Historic Facade Improvement Scheme, the whole thinking behind it was to improve Adelaide by looking at its main streets and looking at the historic buildings in the street, many of which had been basically mucked up in the 50s and 60s, and buildings which had been mucked up in the 50s and 60s had had louvers and things built in front of them, all the decorations smashed off or rendered and stuff like that. And many of these buildings, rightly or wrongly, have fallen short of being recommended for heritage listing, yet they are often pre-World War II or Victorian era buildings. And one of Adelaide's greatest strengths is, compared to other cities on the eastern seaboard and Perth, a high proportion of these buildings, and we could really improve the look of Adelaide by restoring these buildings rather than seeing them either left as is or replaced. And so it was not intended to that this fund be used to tart up sort of modern 60s and 70s buildings. I can think of an example in Rundle Street East, where there's a 70s building that's out of whack with all the other historic buildings. It's not my intention when I initiated this scheme that we put public money towards tarting up buildings that we're not seeking to be ultimately retained and be part of the city's future. So just trying to keep true to the original intent of the scheme, whilst enabling some broadening of its scope to enable conversations to be started with property owners and to be able to apply to rationalising signage and other such measures to improve the look of our main streets. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. It was seconded by Councillor Abiyard. Councillor Abiyard, do you wish to speak to it?
No, no.
Councillor Bellani, the floor is yours.
I'd like to ask a question, Lord Mayor, from the administration. How many applications or uses of this scheme, or in dollar terms or numbers, have we had in recent times?
Through the presiding member, this program has been in place for 4 years. We've held workshops with council to review the guidelines to enable more uptake of the scheme. To date, we haven't had any uptake.
So, Lord Mayor, I have a concern. We've tried to engage the use of this scheme, and it is a very good scheme, and I understand where you're coming from, Councillor Wilkinson. My question is, in my own mind, if you're going back to narrowing it to quite a, we're using the world pre-World War II historic character buildings, which is probably doesn't sit well with me, those exact words, but we still haven't had any uptake when we've tried to expand the use of the definition of historic in this guideline. So I would be nervous if we narrow it back again, that it's just going to sit there and not actually achieve anything. So I guess in that context, I will foreshadow the recommendation as printed, only because I genuinely want people to use this scheme. And I know that we've tried campaigns, we've actually taken this to them as an opportunity. They have to be willing to, you know, participate and contribute and make the investment. But I'm just nervous that this is not going to actually achieve a better outcome for this program. So that's just my view, and I'll leave it up to others to make their own decision.
Thank you, Councillor Marnie. So we've got an alternate motion before us from Councillor Wilkinson. Any debate, members? Councillor Abiyard, you reserved?
No.
So I'm going to go... No, Deputy Lord Mayor.
Just wondering if we can take it in parts, Lord Mayor, the two components of the amendment.
You would need to look to Councillor Wilkinson to seek comfort on that.
Sorry, it's my amendment. Please ignore me,
Lord Mayor. Certainly, Deputy Lord Mayor. Now, back to the mover, Councillor Wilkinson.
Members, if you just sort of visually drive along Hutt Street or Rundle Street and just think of some nondescript 1970s building, you know, do you want to see public funds directed towards tarting that up? I mean, the intention of this amendment is so that we're not directing public funds towards starting up a building like that. We're only directing it towards the historic buildings that make those main streets Adelaide. I could think of some examples, but I don't want to get in trouble by naming particular businesses. There's that not been kosher. So, I mean, in Hindley Street, we have only just this last week seen the demolition of about 60 or 70 metres of historic facades on the southern side of Hindley Street. That's a real loss for Adelaide. I've seen the replacement development. It's a sort of a mirror, black glass and steel. Could be anywhere. You know, so rather than actually enriching Adelaide and building on our strength, we're just, because they weren't heritage listed and because we hadn't, you know, been able to get this scheme taken up by those property owners, those buildings, it's virtually from the Morford Street up 60, 70 metres up the south side, has been completely demolished. And I don't think Adelaide or Hindley Street, for example, is going to be improved by that. So the intention of this whole scheme is to capitalise on Adelaide's strengths, which is our historic character buildings. That's what people love about Adelaide. I just want to make sure that we keep the focus on this, on restoring those buildings that people love about Adelaide, and not about later buildings. If there's some exceptional modern building post-World War II, there's always the option for administration to report up to council, just as they do for allocations over 30,000.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Members, you have a motion before you. Those in favour? Those against? We carry. Thank you, members. Members, I take you on to item 12.7, City Bikeways feedback from round one of the engagement, page 67, a report to receive. I have a mover with Councillor Abiad. I have a seconder with Councillor Corbell. I hand you to Councillor Abiad.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Look, first and foremost, thank you, Lord Mayor, for calling a special council meeting. I think that's going to give the council the opportunity to focus on a very important issue. Obviously, today we are receiving and noting community feedback in relation to that consultation. And speaking directly to this, I think it's important to take all of that information over the next week, study it, ask all the questions we want to ask, speak to the community further. So when we take that decision to council on Tuesday next week, we are able to determine once and for all what the decision of council would be moving forward in relation to this specific bike infrastructure and the future bike infrastructure in the City of Adelaide. So look, I think the consultation has provided all the information that we need and that we've asked for, and it'll be a matter for council to make a decision at the next special council meeting in that regard. So I'll leave it there, Lord Mayor, because it's a very simple sort of report, receiving and noting. And then I look forward to having a debate later on Tuesday next week.
Thank you, Councillor Abiad. Just for the benefit of all in the gallery, today I called a special meeting of council for next Tuesday at 6 p.m. So this debate is to receive the public consultation and discuss it and ask questions, should you wish to do so, members. Next Tuesday will be decide the design and various associated details with it, and we'll have a single meeting dedicated towards that task. Thank you, Councillor Abiad. I've got Councillor Corbell, who's seconded. Do you wish to speak to him?
I'll reserve my right, Lord Mayor.
Certainly, Councillor. I've got Councillor Martin.
Yes, Lord Mayor. Look, I haven't been aware of this proposal for this matter to be referred to a special meeting of council. Could you enlighten us as to when this occurred and on what basis?
Yes, your recommendation is to receive a
point of order, Lord Mayor, just yes. Getting the words there. We're not referring this matter to a special meeting of council. Just the point of order there.
That is quite correct. The matter which you have before you is to receive the public consultation and discuss it as a group of elected members, which I'm sure you're about to do. However, a decision regarding this matter will need to be had by this council. For that reason, I've called a special meeting of council at 6 p.m. next Tuesday, which will be a single item meeting, of which this will be it. And members, you will have the opportunity at that meeting to discuss matters such as laneway configuration and whatever you see fit at that meeting. So your recommendation here is to receive a report and discuss a report. However, in the interest that we, of course, need to provide our administration with clarity about where to from here, I felt it prudent to call a special meeting on which to do so. That's precisely what I've done. Hope that helps, Councillor Martin.
Okay, that does help, Lord Mayor. I have a question of the administration then. The recommendation suggests that Council receives, not notes, receives the community feedback on the bikeway design typologies and the overall concept of the North-South Bikeway that was made during round one engagement. Now, I am aware of what the typologies are. Do they also include in this recommendation by inference the often repeated request of those who participated in the public consultation to preserve the Frome bikeway, the existing Frome bikeway, as it is?
CEO?
Daniel Bennett, next.
Through the Lord Mayor, we didn't actually specifically ask that question. So we noted all the feedback that we got and that in that process, and that's what's presented in the report.
I'm not sure that I got that clear. I do understand the design typologies were the six or seven designs that were presented and that there were preferences in the public consultation, but I am aware that the public consultation contained a strong body of opinion that none of those typologies described in the consultation should be adopted. Will the matters presented to us at this special council meeting provide an opportunity to discuss the retention of the bikeway as it is in Frome?
Through you, Lord Mayor, thank you. Just to clarify, Councillor, yes, you will be able to discuss that at the meeting next week.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. In that case, I won't debate the matter tonight, but wait until Tuesday.
Thank you, Councillor. I've got Councillor Antigua hand up. Second, then I'll take Deputy Lord Mayor, then Councillor Maloney. So, did you have your hand up before the Deputy Lord Mayor? I'm not sure if you did, Councillor Maloney. Yes, you did. Councillor Maloney, then the Deputy Lord Mayor. Councillor Antigua.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor, look, this entire sorry saga has now reached climax point, I think. It's I'm actually proposing to move an amendment to that. I'm on leave next week. There is no formal council meeting on the 7th, and such has been the glacial pace of this rectification. I don't see why an extra 7 days would make any difference. There are clearly some very important issues that arise out of result of the neverendum that has taken place in respect of matters which we have already decided. I have a host of questions which I want to ask which will be relevant to that, and they include but aren't limited to why it is we continue to consult on matters which are always already the subject of standing council decisions. We have a decision on our books from July of last year which very clearly states that the street is to be returned to two lanes of traffic in some form or another on both sides of the street, and why it is we continue to ask people whether or not they want that, and that's not the design brief is beyond me. But putting that issue aside, we'll come to that. The issue is, Lord Mayor, that there are some, in my view, very serious ramifications from any rectification motion which is put forward on the day. If and when the July 2016 motion is rectified, I foreshadow some very serious and very concerning consequences for the future of the city bike network. We've been given and entrusted with a co-funding arrangement with the State Council, which involves something in the order of $6 million, which my understanding is was contingent upon the rectification of this street in its entirety. Now, to the extent that that cannot be achieved, then I think we have some serious questions as to whether or not this council continues to fund projects of this nature, because quite frankly, if this quasi-modo of street design is returned to different parts of the city, then I think it's a matter which has fallen outside the scope of this chamber. So I certainly will be having some reservations about the amount of money we accept from the state government and whether or not that needs to be dutifully returned, and indeed whether or not we indeed, following on from that, apply a cent more of our funding to this, what was otherwise a very, very reasonable resolution. We had all resolved to keep a separated bike lane, and one which would improve the design of the street, which would improve the trees, would improve the streetscape, and indeed extend it, Lord Mayor. But given the nature of this attack on what is already a very sound and reasonable decision in this chamber, I think we need to ask some serious questions about whether or not the city bike network in its entirety proceeds. So I'd like to be part of that, and I'd ask for the matter to be referred to, and if that requires an amendment, I'm happy to put that up to the meeting on the 14th of July so that this matter can be addressed properly, not with a knee jerk. Whatever.
Okay. Are you proposing, are you making a statement of fact?
Well, that is an amendment I'm proposing.
You are proposing an amendment?
Proposing an amendment of the matter. I think it was the issue of the special council meeting.
Special council meeting is being called for next Tuesday. Sorry, Council, I just want to be clear on what you're asking. The special council meeting has been called for next Tuesday. Are you suggesting it be called for Tuesday week?
Correct.
Is that what you're suggesting?
That's what I'm suggesting.
Okay, and you'd like that as an amendment?
I'm happy to put that. I'm foreshadowing that as part of this. I'm happy to put that as a motion without notice. But wherever that motion, you've called the meeting, but I'm happy to put that as a motion without notice.
Okay. Members, I'll take that as comment at this point in time, and it will go back to the Councillor Abiyad to sum up. It'll be ultimately my decision when we call that meeting. So thank you for your comments, Councillor. I do take them on board. I'll go to Councillor Moran, I believe I've got next.
Oh, what?
No, I'm sorry, I haven't. I've got Councillor Maloney, then I've got the Deputy Lord Mayor, then I've got Councillor Moran. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Look, I just wanted to thank the administration for bringing this report back to us, and you can understand why they brought this report back to us, because I've gone to consultation on design options, and they're getting a very, very clear message from the community that the community doesn't want us to muck, or doesn't want us to muck much, with the existing bike lane. On the basis of that appears to be in contradiction to a motion that we moved, or some people moved, say in my absence in July last year. And so it makes sense for the administration to bring that back to us and bring it to our attention.
DLM, I just will clarify, it was a motion from this chamber. So it wasn't some people, it was this chamber, it was a decision.
My point was that it was not something I voted for. So I just wanted to thank the administration for the detailed consultation that they've done and the broad consultation they've done. I believe it has given us, and will give us, whenever the special meeting happens, whether it's next week or the week after, some very clear direction as to what we ought to be doing. And I just wanted to make it clear from the gallery's point of view that one of the reasons why a meeting needs to be called at that distance is because there needs to be a 5-day working business days for a rescission motion to be put. So a meeting a week out enables a rescission motion to be put. So I think this is a good constructive way forward. There's obviously still a lot of debate to be had. At this stage, all we're doing is noting the consultation results, and we're obviously going to have, I imagine, if Councillor Antic is around, a fiery debate when the time comes. But I think we're in a much better position because we have a very clear understanding of what our community wants. And I might add, I think that community consultation has been instructive in a number of ways. When we first started talking about this, the community consultation appeared to be about whether we should have bike lanes. It's become really clear in the last round of consultation that that issue is put to bed, and the community consultation is now about what those bike lanes will look like. I think the city has moved considerably, and I appreciate that move as a cyclist. So I look forward to the next meeting where we get to actually talk about what we're going to do. But we've got a pretty clear view from our community, and I think it's important that we take it into account.
Members, I do encourage you that should you have any questions regarding the consultation report, this would be your opportunity to ask them. This is the purpose of this meeting. Councillor Maloney, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Yes, I too would be absent next week should that meeting be held next week. So I do hope you do reconsider the date. I'm just talking to you, Lord Mayor. I was just saying, Lord Mayor, that I too would be absent next week if that was the case, if that meeting was called. So I do ask you chaps to reconsider the date. Look, the consultation sent a very clear message to us, and it said don't touch the existing few hundred metres of bikeway. This is a debate on the world's shortest bikeway, in my view. It's a few hundred metres. Is it perfect? Not by any stretch of the, you know, of our own imagination. We could do better. But it's my view that we get on. What the community want now is not another chat fest. They want leadership. They want us to be bold. They want us to make some decisions here. So I welcome a special council meeting, and I hope there is the rescission opportunity, and we can have that debate, and I welcome that. But that's what I'd like the agenda items to really be about. We've noted the consultation, we've heard clearly what's been said, now we have to do something about it, and that is going to be some bold decision making. What your opinion is on that is up to you all individually. My view is that we just get on with the next phase of the bike lane. Let's leave it as it is. And that money from state government is not contingent on us doing anything. And there was never any written rule on that, in my view. And if it is the written view, they can take the money back. We'll do it ourselves. Because what we need is separated bike lanes. Yes, there is design, and Councillor Martin, you had a view at one point that there must be 2.5 million. There are experts that will guide us on that. We can have four lanes of traffic on Frome. That's all within our remit to do now from Puri Street onwards. And maybe we'll have to look at a bike lane that isn't 2.5 or 2.7 metres. But let's just get on. I would really hope that meeting, Lord Mayor, is about decision making. Consultation? Done. We've done it. The message is clear. There's a strong message. It's good. It's been very positive. Let's focus on the positive of this. We have done a lot of good work on this. And in fact, the next section of bike lane is very exciting. The design has been up for consultation, gone down to the parkland, seen what it could look like. That's a really exciting opportunity for our city. So I really hope we get on with, and if the meeting is held whilst I am away, then so be it. Please know that that is my view on it.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. Councillor Moran.
Well, I won't be getting a hat from the gallery, I'm afraid. Look, bold leadership, let's get on with it. I don't understand what Councillor Maloney's talking about. I moved a motion and got a successful resolution some months ago that we return it to four lanes during rush hour. We make a more elegant separation from the bike path and a safer one from the bike path and the pedestrians and the road. That just seems to have been ignored. We've gone out to consultation, and in my opinion, if you don't answer the consultation, you shouldn't have your consultation counted. Now we're obviously going to move a rescission motion. We're going to go on that. It's so frustrating. I'm sure you were there, Councillor Hender. It was a unanimous vote.
For the record, I was not there either, Councillor Moran.
Okay. Whatever. It was a unanimous vote of this council, and yet we've come back with a consultation that I do not think in any way reflects the views of the public at all. It might refute the people in the gallery, but it does not. We door knocked all area councillors, every door in Adelaide City Council area, and the primary focus of the election was to get rid of the dangerous, clunky infrastructure of that particular bike lane. As Councillor Maloney himself said, it's not perfect by any stretch of the imagination. You don't agree with what's there, so support getting rid of it and put something that is perfect, because this was supposed to be built as a prototype to roll out to the rest of Adelaide. It is an awful design, and I think our state government money, if it's not officially contingent on us doing a good job here, I'd take it away. We can't I can't think of a saying that matches that. If we have taken 2.5 years to get to another workshop, don't give us the $12 million. We'll paint some more lines on the road and keep doing it that way. We cannot handle it, and don't give it to us. So the only other plan that attracts me as Councillor Vershaw's is that we do the new design in the northern part, And then we look at that and then go back and do it in the existing part. So we swap the stages around. I'm happy with that. But for God's sake, let's do something. Let's not have a meeting next week when two very involved councillors won't be here. I'm sad we haven't had it tonight, but I think we should stick to our well thought out plan that this is not a good bike lane, the way the infrastructure's there. Vote together, pick one of the plans, and let's not consider the people that consulted that didn't answer the consultation question. They answered the wrong thing. Council has decided to return it to four lanes. Don't keep asking the same question. No, we made a bold, decisive leadership decision, but now we've gone all a dither because a few people have said, oh, I don't like it. I don't like your decision. Too bad, we've made it.
Members, I'm going to speak to this matter and I'm pleased that I'm able to do so. Members, I have two words, 12 million. The single largest investment in cycling infrastructure in the history of the City of Adelaide, I would expect that most people are leaping with joy, popping champagne corks every time they go home, because we will roll out a higher quality segregated cycling infrastructure north, south and east, west, and that is something to celebrate. And we will unashamedly and unapologetically do it at a higher quality than that ill-fated rubbish which was put in 4 years ago. Now, members, that is something to celebrate. That is something to acknowledge. This is an unprecedented partnership. This is an unprecedented investment. This will provide safer cycling outcomes across the City of Adelaide in two key directions. There'll be over 1,000 kids who'll be attending a new high school at the base of the old RAR site. They will enjoy it every day and they will appreciate your leadership for voting for it. So, members, this has got horribly convoluted. We welcome the stakeholder consultation. We appreciate the stakeholder consultation, but members, our ratepayers are our primary responsibility. Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I have a couple of questions. And look, we are in this position, I understand, too, because there are some strong views around this room, including yours, Lord Mayor. But I would like to ask for clarification from the administration on this point that's kicked around in the room, that somehow the government contribution to the construction of bikeways in the City of Adelaide is contingent on council ripping up the existing Frome Street bikeway. Is that the case or not?
I can answer that question, CEO. The discussions with the government with regards to the co-funding package was the government's utter reluctance to marry any of their investment onto a comparable design outcome which we implemented 4 years ago. So thus, the government was looking for a quality outcome for which you are too, for which you voted in July last year. So that's the government's position. The minister would reiterate that if you asked him. I spoke to him. I spoke to him today. So the minister is committed to segregated cycling infrastructure north-south. The minister is equally committed to segregated cycling infrastructure east-west as we are, at an altogether higher level of specification than what we implemented several years ago. I don't know why we're apologising for lifting ourselves to a higher standard.
Lord Mayor, I thank you for the lecture, but the question was, is the state government contribution to bikeways in Adelaide contingent on this council ripping up the Frome Street bikeway?
Of course it is.
Language, dramatic language brings about different emotions, councillor. So in answer to making modifications to and improving the design outcome and the safety of it.
Okay, Lord Mayor, I hear your answer and I don't think I'm satisfied, but I'll move on. The second question then is, there is discussion around the room about a rescission motion. Is the administration in possession of a motion to rescind the decision of council to allow four lanes of traffic to be returned to Frome?
That's the current situation. You have to have a rescission motion to put two
lanes. I'm asking, does the administration have a rescission motion in respect of the July decision repeated in December?
I'm going to bring that matter to the attention of Councillor Abiyard. Can you answer that question, please, Councillor?
Lord Mayor, this afternoon there was a motion lodged after you announcing a special council meeting that I did send to the CEO to sign off on, which was a motion on notice of the next special council meeting, which includes a rescission motion and another compromise position that I think is suitable moving forward. And that will be presented to that council. And it was also emailed to all councillors this afternoon.
Thank you,
Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I've been in meetings since 5 o'clock, and so I haven't been able to read emails, unlike some of the councillors who do during the course of meetings, but I will check them the moment this meeting is over. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Corbell.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Yes, actually, that was my question as well. I wanted a point of clarification, and whenever we hold the meeting, the special meeting of council, whether it's next Tuesday or it's put off to another date, as requested by Councillor Enzik and Councillor Mullany, I would like it clarified in the administration's comments about whether or not it is this funding from the state government is contingent on the ripping up of the existing Chrome Street bikeway infrastructure. Because to me that was a pivotal point that influenced my decision to support the removal of Chrome Street bikeway. That was the key pivotal decision. It was for me about getting value for money, and we were getting $12 million of separated bikeways, which to me is $1 million or $2 million to extend a section of the Chrome Street bikeway or implement a separated bikeway somewhere else into the city to a lesser standard. So we can do so much more, but it was contingent on that. So I really do need clarification for that. In terms of the consultation tonight, we're not really debating. We've kind of shifted into debate because a couple of councillors have said they're not going to be here when they wanted to get some things off their chest just in case they're not. And I think we shouldn't really be debating because we're just going to debate at the meeting. To come back to the consultation, it was a broad consultation, and the administration went to great lengths up and above our consultation policy and engagement policy to seek input from the community. And it was the local businesses, it was the local residents, and it was much broader than that. It was the visitors to the city, it was internet engagement, community workshops, they went door knocking. So I have confidence in the findings of the feedback that we've received. And as really interestingly, it comes to the fore that the community do not want to see any change to Chrome Street bikeway. To me, that's what really comes strongly through in this feedback process, is that they want separated bikeways. Everyone wants separated bikeways. That seems to be resounding across council. We're debating something that we all agree on. We want separated bikeways. The community wants it as well, but they don't want to see changes made to the existing infrastructure. So rather than going into the debate any further, I just wanted to point out those aspects from my position.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Councillor Lane, you have another question?
I've got a question for the CEO, please. When a recommendation comes to the special council meeting, whenever it is, informing that recommendation, because what I hear actually is, well, there's a bit of nuance on the table, but most people, we acknowledge that the first section's not brilliant and some want to rip it up, some don't, so that's a nuance there, but we all agree that it needs to be improved. Whether it comes as we roll out the bikeway and we go back to that bit later, or my question is, can we get a recommendation, or is there going to be the opportunity for you to form a recommendation? I actually think 8 out of 10 elements, we are on the same page, except for, you know, ripping up. Is going to come back?
You lead into a question, you are.
Well, I'm trying to work out how the administration is going to get us to a point through a recommendation process, through a special council meeting process, where we can get some decision making.
Congratulations.
Well, we've talked about special council meeting in this context.
I move the motion to be put.
You move that every motion.
All right, CEO is going to answer that question, then I'm going to go back to Councillor Abiyad to sum up.
Through the Lord Mayor, look, just want to clarify a couple of things. First of all, the calling of the special meeting. Under our standing orders, I'm required, I must, at the request of the Lord Mayor, call a special meeting, and that's been enacted today, so that is a part of our standing orders. As far as the report to Council goes at the special meeting, we'll work hard to provide a balanced report for you that will enable you to adopt a reasonable solution to the challenge ahead. So that's our task over this next few days, is to prepare a report that will enable you to make an informed decision, and that's what we'll try to do, covering all aspects of the requirements to make that decision.
And would that report include an option for rescission? Is that what you just said at the end there? I know, but only if that comes from a councillor. I'm just trying to work out the process in terms of...
Through you, Lord Mayor, look, we'll be responding to the motion that Councillor Abiyad has put forward today as part of the reporting process.
Okay, members, without further ado, I'm going to hand you back to Councillor Abiyad to sum up to receive this report.
Lord Mayor, in acknowledging some of the information, I mean, a lot of councillors tonight have said that they've heard the community loud and clear. And look, there is definitely messaging in here of 27% of business that don't want anything changed, but there is also 14% of business that want things changed. So let's not sit here and completely ignore that there is an element of our community that haven't come around with us on that journey. Residents, 31% don't want anything changed. 14% want change. They want it to go back. Okay, then we've got, when we're looking at the consultation, surprisingly, every council deputation wants nothing changed. That's the gallery for you. Bike riders want nothing changed. That's the gallery.
That's not true. That's just not true.
So fundamentally, this is the data that's currently here. That when we're talking about ratepayers at the City of Adelaide and the users of the City of Adelaide, we have a responsibility for both. And that's coming very clear through this consultation. But some of you would have also received emails today from ratepayers that said they weren't consulted. They were on that street. Their businesses, I've received three today in writing saying they were not consulted. They were not approached. So we need to take all that into account. And then asking the question, which I did today, was how many of the 87 odd X people that we've consulted with were ratepayers? And obviously there's different in different categories. It was just under 50% that were ratepayers in the City of Adelaide. So we're not talking huge numbers here, but it's important. This is a city for everyone. It's a city for South Australia. So it's important that we take all this into account. But I do not accept that we've heard the message loud and clear because 27% want something, but 14% don't want it. As a council, we have to be equitable. We have to take everyone on that journey, and sometimes we'll all have to lose a little bit to win at the end. Because what I don't want is to see, as a result of consultation over consultation over consultation, a fatigue from our community and a total give up on doing anything in the city when it comes to bike infrastructure, because not one councillor has stood not in support of a separated bikeway, a south to north, a north. Everything we've done, everything we've stood for is for a multi-channel approach to transport. No one doesn't want cycling in the City of Adelaide, but we need to acknowledge that we need to take more people with us on this journey, and that's what the consultation also tells us. So please keep that in mind.
Thank you, members. Report to receive. Those in favour? Those against? Carried. Thank you for your debate, members. Members, item 12.8. Second quarter reporting, strategic plan 2016 to 2020, 2016 to 2017 integrated business plan. To note, can I have a mover, please, members? Councillor Martin's moving. Councillor Antig, I think, had no. Councillor Moran. Councillor Martin, would you wish to speak to that matter?
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to that matter? Members, do you have any debate on that matter? Councillor Martin, to sum up?
Summed up, Lord Mayor.
Members, for the debate. Sorry, for the vote. Those in favour? Those against? We will carry that item 12.8. I take you to 12.9, members. 4-year delivery of strategic plan page 86 to note. Can I have a mover? Councillor Slama, followed by Councillor Clarahan. Councillor Slama, do you wish to speak to it? Reserving your right. Councillor Clarahan. Members to the floor. Members, I'd like to say, on behalf of everyone here, I'd like to thank administration for an exhaustive piece of work. Well done. Councillor Slama, to sum up?
Sum up.
Members, for the vote. Those in favour? Those against? We carry. Members, 12.11, progress of motions by elected members.
12.10, Lord Mayor.
My mistake. 16.17, quarter revised forecast QF2. To note and approve. Can I have a mover, please? Councillor Moran is moving. Can I have a seconder? Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to it?
No, thank you.
Councillor Wilkinson, do you wish to speak to it? Members to the floor. Councillor Martin.
Yes, Lord Mayor, I do wish to say something about this. Can I say that this represents for me an illustration of the way in which the demise of the old committee system is, in my view, endangering decision making. This paper tonight absolutely needs a workshop, not a rubber stamp. For example, it's proposed at slide 4 that from the QF2, that is the end of December, administration will carry forward, that is transfer from this year's budget, more than $2 million and put it into next year. Now, I'd like to have a conversation about that. I'd like to know whether that is, in fact, the best thing to do or whether it might be better to put that money somewhere else. At slide 22, total income is up a lot. Our costs have risen too, but we're showing a really healthy surplus, and I'd like to have that conversation too. At slide 5, it shows the Adelaide Aquatic Centre lost $250,000 until December. $250,000, not a full year result. That's up to December. Now, that's a matter that requires urgent discussion, Lord Mayor, not a rubber stamp. And costs have blown out on some projects in the capital area from slide 7 onwards, including works associated with private companies. Those costs have varied now by between 25% and 50%. And the Queen Adelaide renovation, costs have shot up from $396,000 to almost $550,000. That's a huge increase for the Queen Adelaide Room, and we haven't talked about that. And at slide 14, one of the initiatives identified as a Parklands strategic management goal, which is not a high priority, has been allocated $250,000. Now, I'd like to have the discussion about why that one was more important than the dozens, hundreds of others. And this paper contains a short explanation of a new 10-year capital renewal program being developed for the central market, but it's silent on the detail of the central market operating loss, which is $650,000. Now, I won't be voting for this, not for any reason other than I don't think that I can say with any confidence that I have scrutinised this, that I understand it in the way that my electors would want me to. And frankly, I would ask in future that this stuff is discussed in more detail at committee. It's that important.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Members? Councillor Wilkinson, you seconded. Would you wish to speak to it? Councillor Moran, back to you. Who moved?
Summed up.
Members, those in favour? Those against? We carry. Thank you, members. Members, I take you to item 12.11. Progress of motions by elected members. It is a report to note. Councillor Abiyad is moving. Can I have a seconder, please, members? Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Abiyad, do you wish to speak to it?
No.
Councillor Wilkinson, a seconder. Members, any debate? Councillor Abiyad, back to you to sum up. Summed up with the nod. Those in favour? Those against? We carry item 12.11. 12.12, members, LGA Ordinary General Meeting to endorse. You have four recommendations, I understand, on page 195. Do I have a mover? Councillor Abiyad, seconded by Councillor Moran. Councillor Abiyad, do you wish to speak to this? Councillor Moran, do you wish to speak to this?
Reserve my right.
Members to the floor, DLM.
Lord Mayor, look, I don't have any particular views about any of these motions, and they may have come from all sorts of different sources, but I did attend recently in your stead a Metropolitan Local Government Group meeting, MLGG, is that right? At which it was suggested that when people want to take motions to the LGA, it would make good sense to take them to the Metropolitan Local Government Group first, where they can be discussed with a wide range of councils in order to perhaps get some endorsement, so that when we do take something to the Local Government Association meeting, we're more likely to have some success. So I wonder if I can move an amendment to this, which is that we, if we are going to, as I said, I don't have a particular view about any of the motions, but if we are going to do it, that that we, how would we word it? That we endorse submissions of the following notice of motions to the Local Government Association Board meeting during reading after discussion at the MLGG. Would that work? That wording work? And perhaps a paragraph two, that feedback that the CEO be authorised or delegated to make amendments to the motions in light of the discussion at the MLGG or something to that effect.
I think we see the intent of what you're looking to do. With regards to administration, just mind sure, have we captured the intent of that and in terms of the words reflecting?
Through the presiding member, yes, I think that's fine. The LGA does require a resolution of council for motions to be submitted, but I think your intent is clear here. We can take these to the MLGG, but we will need to submit them to the LGA probably prior to having the opportunity to raise them at the LGG, just from a timing issue.
Thank you. So, have I got a second there?
Yes, you've got a second there with Councillor Clare Hand, so you can continue.
So, yes, just very briefly, the group indicated that they wanted this to happen and that that would enable some free-ranging discussions with other councils that are metropolitan councils. That's about half the council group, because there's a metropolitan local government group and there's a regional local government group. So if we take it to the metropolitan group, we can have the discussion in a friendly and less formal environment, get the input and contribution of our fellow metropolitan councils, and fine-tune our motions so that we actually get some traction with them when we take them through to the LGA. That's my intent. Thank you.
Okay, so DLM, you're happy with the wording on your amendment. You've got a seconder with Councillor Clarehan. Would you like to speak to the amendment, Councillor Clarehan? Members, any debate on the amendment? DLM, to sum up on the amendment? Members, to vote on the amendment. Those in favour? Those against? We carry the amendment. We have an amended substantive before you. Your mover on the substantive was Councillor Abiyard. So, in absence of any debate on the amended substantive, I will hand you back to Councillor Abiyard. Councillor Clarehan, were you putting in your hand?
No, I just vote.
Okay, those in favour, members? DLM, are you voting? Yep. Those against? We carry. Thank you, members. Right, we go to item 13.1. We've got questions on notice. Councillor Martin's got a question on notice, of which I am going to read the answer.
Lord Mayor, I'm happy to take that as written. I think the ratepayers who raised it will be very happy with that response.
You're happy to take that as read?
I am.
Members, we'll take that as read. It'll be distributed in your papers, if you've not already seen. Thank you, members. Thank you, Councillor Martin. Any further questions without notice, members? There are none, so I'm going to take you to motions on notice. Item 15.1, page 200 of your papers, Councillor Moran.
Excuse me, Lord Mayor. Just before we, Councillor Moran moves, because I'm declaring a conflict of interest, given that I am on the board representing this council of two events that are held in the parklands.
Thank you for advising your fellow elected members, Councillor Maloney. Councillor Moran.
Lord Mayor, can I query something? I mean, obviously, as a leaseholder in the parklands, I have a conflict of interest, but are we talking specifically about all leaseholders, or are we just talking about those under the Major Events Act and the Motorsport Act?
I'm presuming it's the latter, but I would need to take clarification from Councillor Moran in terms of her intent.
Well, I don't think the motion is specific, is it? Any licence or lease to go for events in the park lands, so I don't know, I'd have to ask the administrator. I think it's not very clear.
It might strike to your intent when you crafted the motion, because you. But I'll hand to Claire Mockler if Claire can assist.
It doesn't really matter my intent.
Yeah, through the presiding member, my understanding was it was any licence or license that council has the power to grant to an event in the parkland.
So I had a conflict of interest as the CEO of the Adelaide Festival.
Thank you, Councillor Vershaw. DLM?
I have a conflict of interest as a board member of the festival.
Thank you, DLM. Councillor Moran, the floor is yours.
Okay. Look, I'll move as printed, but I would like to, as I can't adjust a motion on notice, I would like to invite anybody that felt that.
Sorry, Lord Mayor, could I also declare a conflict of interest? I'm on the board of the Adelaide Festival.
Certainly, certainly. You can. Thank you very much, Councillor Clare Hand. We've still got a quorum just. Members, I would look to a seconder, I think, for the purpose of this debate. We're going to need one. Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Moran, back to you.
Look, in discussing it before, after I'd written this motion, which was in response to, if I could have a little bit of leeway at the beginning, to Arnie's, the media report of Arnie's kiosk in the parklands having trouble with the, what they described as gouging of 28% for the event surrounding it, which does seem quite outrageous. However, my motion is just specifically talking about that payment of the percentage of profit taken by the event surrounding it. It is not referring to the sponsorship deals. And I think a suitable amendment would be, if somebody wanted to move it, that the business would be allowed to trade, but the council seeks to reduce the percentage of money that the event takes, but accepts the conditions of sponsorship for the events. And so I'm talking, I'll move.
So we can either deal with that as an amendment, which we can debate now, or you could suggest a variation to the mover. And we would need to seek the comfort of the seconder and then the chamber. So, Councillor Moran, would you like to read that out again, and then I'll seek comfort from your seconder and your fellow councillors.
All right. That the that any licence or lease grants with events in the parkland includes. It's very difficult now, isn't it, to not rewrite it. Includes a clause stating that while the business must accept the conditions of sponsorship, we seek to minimise the amount. I think just preclude it. That our businesses do not have to pay a percentage of their profits to the event.
Okay, I'm just trying to capture the right words for the purpose of the debate. It will come to you, Councillor Abiyad, unless you've got a question. Okay, yes.
In my opinion, I think if this is deferred and dealt with, to bring everything we need back in it, because it's quite complex, and I'm happy to chat about that when I'm given the opportunity to talk about it. But there is a fair bit to consider in this that we might not all be across, that's all. I support it wholeheartedly, but I think there's more additions that need to be done.
Okay, that would be up to the mover of the various motions.
I think, with the permission of my seconder, deferred to the next council meeting to take in the administrative comment is reasonably good, but the motion is deficient, I think.
So we've got the info, but the motion doesn't address what we really need it to address. So with the permission, I second all.
I'm happy to move it.
Okay, so we've got a, we were working on a variation of a substantive. We've now got someone to move a deferral. So I need a seconder for the deferral motion. Do I have one? Councillor Martin? Reasons for deferral?
In speaking briefly, Lord Mayor, I think just to obtain more information, but one of the things I'd like to see from the administration is some assurances or potentially more information in relation to the state government as well and events in general, and how that would impact on licences, leases, etc., that we may need to consider moving forward. I know the report brought in some information, but other things that were considered were around potential conflicts between lessors and parklands and events, etc., as around branding, product placement, etc., etc. So we just need to be able to sort of take all that into account in us addressing the motion at that stage.
Okay, so your second to move to defer, which effectively is an amendment, is Councillor Martin. Councillor Martin?
Nothing to say.
Okay, members, any debate on the motion on the amendment to defer? I put that before you to defer, members. Those in favour, those against, we will defer that matter and administration will take on board those comments made by Councillor Abiyath. The substantive now is amended, so I'll just get you to vote on the same thing again. And I go to yes, members, all in favour, those against, so we've now formally deferred that matter. That will come back to the next council meeting. Is that understanding, sir? If we could have the fellow members rejoin us in the council chamber, please. Okay, members, thank you. Thank you, Councillor Moran. We're going to item 15.2, motion on notice to vary. Councillor Ariad, the floor is yours.
Lord Mayor, happy to move as recommended or printed at this stage.
I'll seek a seconder, Councillor. We've got Councillor Moran.
Just a quick comment. If we can digitise most of this process online, I mean, everything's quite transparent and public anyway, it gives the opportunity for council members to be able to go to a website and sort of check the progress of their motions without having to report every week, or every month, or every second month. So if we could consider that, that would be great.
Thank you, Councillor Abiyat. Members, those in favour, those against, we carry item 15.2. Item 15.3, Councillor Martin, motion notice, SA Heritage Council nomination for the Adelaide Parklands. Councillor?
Lord Mayor, I really don't think I need this motion. The administration has agreed to what was proposed. That is a workshop for elected members at point 9 on page 203, so that we can all discuss the consequences of the decision of the Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources State Heritage Unit to investigate the heritage listing of the parklands. If that's happening, I'm happy just to withdraw it.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Appreciate it. We go on to item 15.4. There's no need to vote on that in that case, members. Item 15.4, Councillor Hender, Deputy Lord Mayor, motion notice regarding Gresham Street. Deputy Lord Mayor.
Sorry, I move the motion as printed, seconded.
Seconded by Councillor Maloney. DLM.
Lord Mayor, I understand that there's been some discussion about this in my absence, and I thank you for progressing this on my behalf. So really what I'm seeking here is that we have an allocation of funding of $50,000 as part of the QF3 budgetary process to make some short-term changes in the Gresham Street area, bearing in mind that we're going to do some work on Gresham Place, and there's some real interest in also doing some work in Gresham Street. It's a street that is pretty dodgy at the moment. There's a real opportunity, given that the Bank Street is going to be done up, that we spend some time and money in Gresham Place. The money in the short term would be used to do things like
traffic calming. People use that as a wrap around. They whip around there at high speed to try and avoid that corner. To do some lighting, maybe some public art, the sort of things that will just make a quick, I was going to say quick and dirty, but it's a bit unfair.
Lighter, cheaper, faster,
low-hanging fruit. And then to do some investigation about whether we can take up the Premier's idea of developing a French cluster in this area. We're looking for a report as part of that to see whether there's some, we can actually use the opportunity to upgrade another street. And then if you think about what that would actually bring to Hindley Street, we'd have off Hindley Street, we'd have Bank Street on one side, we'd have Lee Street on the other side, we'd have Peel Street on the other side, we'd have Gresham Place in the street. It will start to make a real impression on how Hindley Street is approached from the King William Street end of the city, and I think we'll start to make a real impression on how Hindley Street is actually operates as a street. So I seek my fellow members' support for this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, DLM. Councillor Mullany, followed by Councillor Slama, followed by Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Mullany.
I'm serving your right.
I will go to Councillor Slama. Councillor Wilkinson.
I spoke briefly with Deputy Lord Mayor Hender about this aspect, and I ask if she would be happy to incorporate this aspect into a motion that following dot points 4 and 5, that the words "and restoration of the historic buildings that line it" be added, such that when we're looking at enhancing Gresham Street, we're actually looking at doing something with the buildings, because on the western side it's lined with historic stone brick buildings, which, you know, if we're looking to enhance, then we're going to ask administration to engage with stakeholders and property owners on the street, extend that conversation to actually restoring the building, stripping the paint off the brick and blue stone, etc. Utilising our either our heritage and centre scheme or our historic site improvements.
We'll get to that as well, Councillor Wilkinson.
As the other public realm works.
Has proposed some words. Do you take those as a variation, or would
we have to vary? Because I know the words have come up on my screen on the end of dot point 4. First of all, may the right of the state government seek the partnership to support the upgrade of Gresham Street. Including the restoration of heritage buildings at Lynch. So I would be happy to take the variation, including the restoration of historic buildings.
DLM, can I provide some advice from the chair just with regards to that? Could I encourage you to decouple those two matters? Because if the state government does have an involvement here, it might be regarding the public realm. We do have incentive schemes and so forth which could assess with the private building, so just marrying those two things together might have an unintended consequence of actually stalling the whole project.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Can I encourage them to be separate?
And I think it should be joined on to the next stop point.
Councillor Wilkinson, I still hope that serves your intent. The intent is the same, but it's...
Well, Mayor, can I seek your advice about that? Councillor Corrigan suggested that those words be added to the next dot point rather than to dot point 4. Can I get your views about that? Request that the administration engage with stakeholders regarding streetscape changes and the restoration of historic buildings, so we actually talk to the building owners about it.
That's entirely applicable. You need just, this is a variation coming from, suggested by Councillor Wilkinson. So yep. Your second on the motion was, Councillor Mullany, are you happy with...
Can you vary a motion on notice?
Yes, because Councillor Wilkinson is doing it, wasn't the mover. So are you happy with that, Councillor Mullany? So members, are you happy with that as a variation? And then I'll hand back to DLM. As per the screen, yes we are, thank you. Okay, so DLM, now have we got any further debate, members? Queries, questions or debate? I don't, so I've got to hand back to the DLM for, Councillor Mullany, you good? You reserved? You're okay? DLM, sum up, members, I put this for your consideration. Those in favour? Those against? We carry. Thank you, members. Thank you, DLM. Councillor Mullany, item 15.5, motion or notice?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'll move as printed in regard to the city ring route and call for a seconder.
Seconded by the Councillor Martin, I think, hand up first.
Thank you. There's a, I just preface that I am certainly no expert on city transport planning. But one thing that seems obvious to me is, and it also seems like a topic that's gone a little bit quiet, is how we are actually progressing, well, how the state government is progressing and us as a partner on the rollout and improvement and enhancement of the city ring route. It's pretty obvious that we, if we focus on removing the traffic that is just cutting through the city as a thoroughfare and encouraging more destination traffic, but we have to give them the infrastructure and enable them to be able to do that. And from my understanding, there's kind of, it's partway there, but there's still a lot of work to be done. And I think actually what I'm really trying to do by this is just raise it on our profile a little bit more so that we can actually understand what's going on and be abreast of the requirements that need to take place and perhaps look at what we need to do to fast track this, because I do think it's an important element of how we encourage traffic movement. When we looked at Frome Street, we looked at the data of cars moving through Frome Street that were destination traffic versus thoroughfare traffic. There was a lot of cars that were just, you know, cutting down Frome Street, for example. So it's probably because it's an easy way to do it. We must, there's a lack of opportunity for them to actually use the city ring route. There's so many, there's traffic signals and there's a lack of signage and maybe some education and promotion that's needed and physical infrastructure upgrade. And most of this does fall on the responsibility of the state government through DIPTI. So I'd like us to, and I know there is some conversation, and I thank the administration for constantly putting this on the discussion on the agenda with the state government, but maybe we need to do a bit more. And I think it's time that we all just got a little bit up to speed on where we're at, and then look at what we need to do next.
Thanks. Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Councillor Martin.
Yes, thank you, Lord Mayor. Look, I'll be brief. I welcome this motion on notice from Councillor Maloney, speaking from a parochial point of view. We have huge traffic volumes in North Adelaide in our major thoroughfares, which are in order of busyness, O'Connell Street, Melbourne Street and Jeffcott Street. And I fear a lot of that is through traffic, encouraged to some extent and addressed by Councillor Maloney's motion 2.2 and 2.3 by poor signage and education. Approaching the city on Main North and Main Northeast Road, the signage says clearly how many minutes it will take to get to O'Connell Street and how many minutes it will take to get to Melbourne Street. And by inference, that is the best route to take. When in fact, somebody preferring a location outside of the city might be better taking a route along East Terrace or West Terrace or wherever. But the signage and the education doesn't provide for that. So there is an opportunity, I think, for a decrease in the volume of traffic going through the city simply because it's directed through signage and lack of education. So this is a timely and potentially effective means of addressing some of our local traffic problems. And I urge members to support it.
Members to the floor, any debate? Councillor Avio? Councillor Maloney to sum up?
Summed up.
Members to the vote, those in favour? Those against, we carry that motion. Thank you, Councillor Maloney. Members, we have a number of items which we're going to seek motions without notice. Members, do we have motions without notice? Councillor Moran.
I have one. I move that the administration be instructed to consult with the businesses along Peel Street to ascertain as to whether the new lighting is too bright. Do I have a seconder?
I'll look for a seconder. Councillor Shaw had hand up first.
First time you've seen me all night, Lord Mayor.
Apologise, Councillor.
Big trouble is. Look, to not to put too fine a point, the lighting in Peel Street is too bright. There are Facebook
pages and pages of people wearing sunglasses and going like this under it. The businesses have, several have rung me and I've wandered down there and spoken to the Lord Mayor, he's been spoken to too. I think it'd be a very easy matter to, I've seen it myself, it's like walking on the face of the sun. It's brighter than daylight. And I don't think that's what we meant. It certainly hasn't got the lovely warm ambience that Sandy is so aware of in lighting. So if we could ask the administration just to go down and have a look at it at night and speak to the business owners and change the globes.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. The Honourable John Rao MP is known to spend a little bit of time in Peel Street. I'll ask him the question. Councillor Wilkinson.
Are we able to follow up on that?
Oh, sorry, Councillor Vershaw, would you like to speak to this matter a second then? I'm being very recalcitrant, I apologise, Councillor. Councillor Wilkinson?
Yeah, just in speaking, I haven't been down to Peel Street at night, but I must say I'm pretty disappointed to hear if this is rightly lit, too white, too bright, given all of the conversations we've been having in recent times about getting more ambient lighting for this, you know, to rise. And I'm going to go down there tonight and have a look. But we've been had numerous conversations with council staff about going to a warmer 2700 Kelvin, not this bright ultra-white light, not being glary. We had a situation in Varden Place where the property owners in Barton Place actually called for all of the Cree spider fittings to be pulled out and replaced with the warmer little Paulson ones because they were too bright and glaring. And yet it sounds like we might have had a similar mistake happen again. So that's just sort of straight from my result. We need to move on now. Fix by this lighting, still happening. So I'll be going down there with interest.
Thank you, Councillor. Members, any further debate? Did I have any further hands? Councillor Vershaw has seconded. Do you wish to speak? Back to Councillor Moran for a summary. Members, to you for a vote. Those in favour? Those against? We carry that item. Members, any further motions without notice? There are none. I will move on to exclusions from the public. Members, we have 5 matters which require an exclusion to the public. I'll take you through each of them. 18.2.1, lease renewal star car park. Those in favour of moving into confidence? Deputy Lord Mayor, seconded by Councillor Moran. Those in favour? Voted. Members, carried. Not voted, carried. Thank you, Judy. Members, item 18.22, strategic property purchase, moved by Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Slava. Those in favour? Carried. Members, 18.2.3, commercial opportunity. Those in favour, moved by Councillor Moran, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Those in favour? Thank you, members. We carry item 18.2.4, quarter two business operations report. Can I have a mover, please, to move into confidence? Councillor Slama, seconded by Councillor Abiyad. Those in favour? We carry. Lastly, item 18.2.5, progress of confidential motions by elected members. Can I have a mover, DLM, seconded by Councillor Corbell. Those in favour, move into confidence. Carried. All members of the gallery and or general public, or both not associated with these matters directly, can I ask you to leave the chamber? meeting this evening. Pardon, Councillor. Sorry, Councillor, cameras will go back on again. My mistake. Put that sentence in reverse. So, members, I will now formally close this meeting at 8:54 p.m. on Tuesday, the 28th of February 2017. Members, thank you for your participation. Greatly for administration. Thank you. Greatly appreciate it.